Let's take a moment and we'll have a word of prayer together as we begin. Father, we thank you for allowing us to come together around the table. And as we gather as people who know that our life is in Christ. It's because of what Jesus Christ has done for us in his death and resurrection that we come to this table. And I pray that this would be a worshipful time, a meaningful time, and that we would recognize your goodness to us in this. I pray that we would come too, knowing that Jesus Christ is King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords, and he is the ruler over all creation, the ruler over every ruler. I ask that you would teach us in your truth. I ask that as we come here, we would come as citizens and children who belong to you, who love you first. We thank you for your good gift to us in your Son, our Savior. Amen. I am always drawn back to this particular picture that is given to us of Jesus Christ in John's Gospel, or in John's Revelation, where he says this as he sees, or we read this as the Lamb steps forward and as Christ steps forward, these words are said first by the heralds, and then, or they're sung by the heralds, and then they're sung, more words are sung by the multitude that's there. It says, and they sang a new song, saying, worthy are you to take the scroll and open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation, and you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth. Then I looked, and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels, numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. As we come to the communion table, we come as people who are doing two things. We are remembering the death of Jesus Christ. Oh, it's not working.
That one's on. Don't share.
Maybe I didn't turn it on.
There, we've got a label.
But we come doing two things. We come remembering the death of Jesus Christ on our behalf and his resurrection. And we also come looking forward to the fact that he will be king. He is king, and he will be crowned in his fullness one day. And as we look forward to that, we recognize that even now we serve him as king. One of the things that I was thinking about as I was thinking of all of the mandates and the extra stuff that's coming to us that we're working through and dealing with is I was thinking about the fact that I have been commanded to preach. The scripture makes it very clear that I am commanded to preach and preach the gospel. But one of the things that I also was thinking about was, although I am commanded to preach, the command to sin is going to last far longer. Because one day I will no longer be preaching, but I will still be singing. And this is where I look and I say, we serve a king who has called us to praise and worship him. And I think that that is a good thing for us. We are people who are called to be worshipers of the king, and we will be worshiping him with multitudes forever and ever because of what he has done. So this is where, as I come to the table, we come recognizing the sacrifice that was made for us, and we come recognizing who the one is who made the sacrifice. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He is the one who is the head over all earthly authorities that try to put themselves up above him. That's it. That's who we serve. And so anytime the earthly authorities try to step past Jesus, essentially what they have done is they've stepped outside of their sphere of authority. So we walk through this carefully, wisely, considerately, desiring to honor. But we also walk through this knowing that Jesus is the center all the time. And serving Jesus is central for us all the time. And hearing Jesus is central all the time. And as we come to the table, the other thing that we remember is that we come desiring to be people who are in right relationship with Christ. We're looking inward to see that our hearts are where they should be. And that's why when Paul warns in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, he warns against taking this in an unworthy manner. So that's why we have our time of silent self-examination. And I'm going to encourage you to take a moment right now and let's be involved briefly in silent prayer. And then after that, we're going to partake of the elements.
Father, we thank you for who you are. We thank you that you came on this earth. You gave up your body for us. And as we think of what you did, we can never repay it. We confess that we are sinful and that we need a Savior. And Lord, you did that. And Lord, we look forward to the day when you come again and put an end to all sins. Bring in righteousness forever. And Lord, we want to serve you. We want to give you all the praise and honor and glory.
As we look into Christ's establishment of this ordinance for his followers, we read these words looking in Matthew 26, and you're very familiar with them. Please take the bread that has been distributed, that you picked up. And Christ is speaking to his disciples on the night before that he died. Says this to them in Matthew 26, verse 26. Sorry, just give me a second to get this open. My thumbs aren't working great. Listen. Yeah, I may have to rip it. Yeah, I just. Okay. In Matthew 26, it says this in verse 26. As they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body." And as we partake of this, we are eating in remembrance of the one whose body was broken for us. And we are remembering that the one whose body was broken for us is the King of Kings and the Lamb who will appear, the one who is worthy to open the seals. Let's eat it together.
Heavenly Father, we partake of this second element, and it reminds us of the blood that you shed for us. Lord, how you were the worthy lamb that gave of his life, the only worthy lamb that was to be a payment for our sin, a sin that we could not pay ourselves because we are not the worthy ones. Father, we thank you for this time to gather, to be able to partake in this remembrance, this time that is also a time of thanksgiving. As always, already has been mentioned, how one day we will stand together as believers before the throne, and we will be singing, "Worthy is the Lamb." And Father, we thank you for this time, in Jesus' name.
One of the interesting things that comes out very clearly in, or I shouldn't say, I've heard again and again, and possibly you've heard things said to this effect too, that there would be far less wars in our world if the people who were commanding them actually had to get out front and sacrifice themselves. When you think about those who are in positions of authority and rule in government, if they actually had to do the fighting, they would be far more hesitant about actually sending people off to war. And I think that that's an interesting reflection on the reality of human rule. The tendency for human rule in a broken world is always to do things to the advantage of yourself. That is very, very frequently the case. We see that. Many times among those who are in positions of authority. In fact, we've even heard some things recently as we take a look at what's unfolding inside of our government in Canada that have caused us to take a look and say, that's not right. But here's the great thing about the righteous king. The great thing about the righteous king, the amazing thing, is that he went out in front of us. That he sacrificed himself and he shed his blood in the great battle against sin and hell and death. And so when we come together, as we partake of this, we take and we remember the blood of Jesus Christ shed for us. And we use the lamb metaphor, and that's important, but we also use the king metaphor, because we recognize that this righteous king didn't send us into battle. He went into battle himself, and his blood was shed for us. So we read these words when we take a look at Matthew 26, and he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." Let us drink it together. Father, we thank you for your Son, our King, a King who would sacrifice himself. This is an amazing thing to consider, and yet we see it's rooted in your very character, and it has always been your purpose, that in your rule, you would be a God who sacrifices, and in your call to rule, you would be a God who teaches that rulers sacrifice, and your Son would show it in a special way. Your Son, who is far above us and beyond us, who owes us nothing, would die on the cross for our sin. Lord, we thank you for this. And I pray as we've taken this time together around the table, that we would have been captured in a fresh way in our thinking to understand the reality of what it means that the Lamb and the King of Kings died on the cross for us and has given us new life. We pray this in the name of your Son, our Savior. Amen. Well, I'm going to pass it back to Leif and Tanya right now. They're going to continue on as leading us in our time of worship. And we look forward to our time with the Word in just a few minutes. one, but before we do that, let's take a moment and let's have a word of prayer together. Father, we thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you for the opportunity to take time and to be in your word. And I pray as we come to this truth, which we know well, which many of us are very familiar with, may we work to understand the heart of it and not simply look at the words, but consider the meaning and the effect of the meaning in our hearts and lives. I pray this in Jesus' name. At the end of the book of Ecclesiastes, and I'm going to talk about that before we actually get into the passage that we're looking at today. At the end of the book of Ecclesiastes, Solomon writes these words, "Of the making of many books, there is no end." Listen to that. Okay, the Ecclesiastes is written in kind of a world-weary tone, but it says at the end of it, "Of the making of many books, there is no end." For those of you who don't particularly like books, you might say, "You're right, there's way too many books." But earlier in the same book, Solomon says this. He says, "A fool's voice is known by the abundance of his words." Interesting, isn't it? "Of the making of many books, there is no end. A fool's voice is known by the abundance of his words." These are interesting comments to me, coming from a man who wrote a number of books and who used a lot of words, that he would say that. But then what he means as he makes those statements in all of this is that humans can write or speak a lot of empty words. Humans can produce a lot of empty words. And words only really are of value when they have meaning and when we mean them. After all, what's the value of an empty compliment? How many of you are happy when you get an empty compliment? Or the value of an empty promise? Or the value of an empty apology? Or the value of an empty prayer? I think of the words of Claudius, the murdering brother in Shakespeare's Hamlet, who attempts to pray at one point, and as he attempts to pray, he says this, and this phrase, this sentence from Claudius has stuck in my mind ever since I read it back in high school. It's just really stuck in my mind. It says, "My words fly up, my thoughts remain below. Words without thoughts will never to heaven go." You might have heard that phrase before. "My words fly up, my thoughts remain below. Words without thoughts will never to heaven go." Empty prayers just bounce off the ceiling. Today, as we continue in Luke's good news account, we're looking at a prayer that is probably being repeated in an empty way more times than any other. We're in Luke 11, and we're looking at what we call the Lord's Prayer. And as I think about the Lord's Prayer, I think about the fact that whole generations of school children repeated it for no other reason than the fact that they were supposed to. Now, I know that there is a battle on the part of Christians to make sure that the Lord's Prayer stayed in the school, or to try and keep the Lord's Prayer within the school. And they did so because of the fact that they rightly understood that as we cut ourselves off from the root, we would actually see things happening in our country that would not be good. And so that was legitimate on that basis. But I know at the same time that as the Lord's Prayer was prayed week after week, the vast majority of kids said it for no reason other than the fact that they were supposed to. And they could rhyme it off, but it was strictly rote. It meant next to nothing to them. And there are faith traditions where the Lord's Prayer can be said frequently and repetitiously without a whole lot of thought. It's used as a means of penance. So in other words, if you've done something wrong, then what you do is you make up for it by rhyming the Lord's Prayer off 10 times in a row. Now that's interesting because Jesus Christ talks about the fact that prayer is not supposed to be empty repetition like the pagans do. But this is how the Lord's Prayer ends up being used. And of course, that's not why it was given. We read these words as Jesus speaks to his
disciples as he's asked a question in response to that question. Now, Jesus was praying in a certain place. And when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray as John taught his disciples. And he said to them, when you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread and forgive us our sins. For we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation. Luke does not record everything that Matthew records of that prayer. He gives us something of more of a shorter version of the prayer. But as he writes this, what we see is that the disciples understand that Jesus Christ has a deep relationship with God. And they want the same. And so what happens is someone, we don't know who, but one of the disciples asks him to teach them how to really pray. How to come to the Maker of heaven and earth, their heavenly Father, as they should. And when Jesus responds, he doesn't just respond, well, you know, everyone comes in their own way. As long as you really feel it and it makes you feel good, that's how you pray. Now, I'm saying that because of the fact that sometimes I think what happens is there is kind of a flippant approach to prayer, or there is a, well, it very much comes out of the nature of who I am as to how I pray. You know, how I talk to God and how I approach God. The big guy upstairs, my buddy, whatever he might be. But Jesus Christ instead gives meaningful words and truth. Even if we can fall into repeating them as empty rote. And so when we come to the Lord's Prayer here, something that many of you have memorized, something that many of you said many times through the years, the thing that I want us to do is I want us to capture what's going on here rather than allowing it to be something that we know only at rote. Because prayer is worship, and Christ makes that clear. And we understand that our prayers will always be incomplete, and we understand that, as the Apostle Paul writes, the Spirit helps us in our weakness so that he takes our prayers and he makes prayers that are incomplete and makes them what they should be as they come to God. But this is what I know. I know that if you're a child of God, I know that if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, you want to pray meaningful prayers. You want to pray prayers that matter, words that matter. You don't want to say prayers that are empty. So as we read here, what we're given is not a rote paragraph. Instead, Christ is explaining for us a pure, fourfold act of worship. And he shows us how to come to God. And he shows us the truth that shapes a true praying heart. And this is what we can understand in this. These are the truths that shape a true praying heart. As we take a look then, the first thing that Christ tells us is that true prayer and a true praying heart, true prayer is devoted to God's person. And that's why it begins, Father, hallowed be your name. Every single human who lives in this world, every single human of understanding living in this world, views it in one of three ways. They understand it in one of three ways. They either understand or believe that they are living in a world that is without meaning, or they believe that they're living in a world with gods that are cruel or weak or flawed in some other way. And so they don't quite know how to relate to them, but they think that they're cruel or weak or flawed. Or they live in a world that they believe is ruled by the triune God, perfect in righteousness, perfect in justice, perfect in love, perfect in grace. We're in the third category. At least, I would imagine if you're here, you're here because you're in the third category. You believe, as I do, that we worship the true God, the triune God, perfect in righteousness, justice, love, and grace, and eternally in relationship the three in one, eternally in relationship, because he is three persons. And this is why Jesus Christ starts out with this. Because if God is not worshipped, everywhere he is not worshipped, his creation is broken and carries the seed of its own destruction. That's what happens. So he says, may your name be reverenced. May you be acknowledged as the only one who is worthy of worship. And it's no wonder that we begin by praying that his reputation and his glory would be acknowledged, that he would be reverenced and worshipped as he deserves. Because only in a world where, and among people where, God is hallowed, he is reverenced, he is upheld, only in that world can we see good done. God must be glorified. And a true praying heart understands that he is our highest joy and goal and aspiration. He is the one we must look to. And a true praying heart, if there is an ask involved in the prayer, has that ask shaped by the fact that God is our highest joy and goal and aspiration? Father, hallowed be your name. May you be reverenced. May you be the one who is glorified. May you be the one who is held up. May you be our great joy and our great delight and our highest aspiration. You know what that does right away when we start our prayer and when this shapes our heart? It means that we don't pray for stupid things like Lamborghinis. Because when God is our highest joy and our highest aspiration, then what that means is that every ask that we make is tinged with the understanding of what really is the priority. We're far less likely to ask for foolish things when our prayer is ultimately beginning with the highest and the most important one being acknowledged as our great priority. Second thing that we see is Christ tells us about true prayer and the praying heart is that we see that true prayer is devoted to God's plan. It's devoted to his person. It's devoted to his plan. Your kingdom come. Now, if we were to take a look in Matthew, it says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. But here, as Luke records it, he records the essence of it. The other is a further development and explanation of this. Your kingdom come. We desire that God's will is done because we look at this broken world and we know that the great hope of humankind is the kingdom of God. So here and now, your kingdom come means that God changes our hearts and minds as his citizens so that we walk in step with him. Here and now, we pray that more will live like citizens of the kingdom. Here and now, we pray that more will pursue his goodness and peace and beauty and truth. This is growing out of the fact that more that we reverence him. As we reverence him and recognize him as the highest priority, we recognize too that our hope is in his plan. And we're praying for the victorious return of the king, when all of the brokenness, all of the evil, all of the pain, and all of the sadness and frustration will be ended. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, as it says in Revelation, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore. For the former things have passed away. And the true heart understands. The true prayer understands that God is our highest priority and his kingdom is our only hope. I'm reading a book right now that I've been lent that's called Homo Deus. And Homo Deus is written by, it was written in 2015 by a history professor. And this history professor is considered to be a brilliant thinker. The book's widely acknowledged. It was a New York Times bestseller and thought highly of. This history professor began with the premise that mankind has solved the problems, this is 2015, mankind has solved the problems of famine and plague and war, and that it's time to move on toward becoming fully godlike, including immortality and things like that. These are our next great problems to solve. But 5 years later, there's great concern about a plague, isn't there? 5 years later, the potential number facing famine and starvation has just grown by hundreds of millions. It's multiplied by a factor of 4 in the last few weeks. Now you stop and you think about that. And we're glad when good things happen. And we're glad when in some way sickness or suffering is lessened. But we know this. We know that in this world, the best human plans and efforts will still break down and they'll still fail and they'll still fizzle. And now as we see good things happen, we do see sometimes small and temporary tastes and reflections of God's kingdom. And we're joyful for that. But this is what we know. We pray as people devoted to his plan. We pray for his plan. We pray for his kingdom to come. We pray for his will to be done. Because our plan isn't enough. All of our efforts aren't enough. We need him. And we need the work that he is doing to save us. Third thing that true prayer recognizes, and this is, you probably see in this, I haven't used this word yet, but really, you see that the continuing theme is the word dependence. And the third thing that true prayer and the praying heart recognizes is that we are dependent. We are dependent on his physical provision. Absolutely dependent on his physical provision. And so it says, give us each day our daily bread. As he teaches the disciples to pray, they're of course in a different circumstance than us. He's speaking to people for whom starvation might be a real possibility. They're one bad harvest or one family disaster away from starvation in many cases, part of what was called a subsistence society. And in response to that, as God gave his law in the Old Covenant, God gave law that provided some protections. And in that, the Old Covenant was unique from the ways that societies around it were structured because the Old Covenant placed an emphasis on the community taking care of the poor. So there were gleaning laws and there were tithes and there was the commands to help widows and orphans. But we know this, for them starvation was very, very possible and it was not that far away. So Jesus Christ says, as you pray, the praying heart recognizes that you are completely dependent on God for his physical provision. And he says bread here, but of course he's talking about more than just baguettes or crusty buns or Italian loaf or whatever your favorite form of bread might be. The word here represents all of our physical needs and provisions. I'll give you a fancy word that you can throw in here. This is a synecdoche, okay? Synecdoche means one word that is representative of the whole. So for instance, when we talk about the power of God, we talk about his mighty arm. Or when you talk about an army coming against someone, you might say the arrow of that country flew. Synecdoche. So this is the word bread is used here to represent all of our physical needs. And this is a very important one for us, I think, to be clear on. Even as people who live in a highly and an enormously prosperous society. Because really today, we receive what we need for the day so easily and so plentifully that many forget the source. In fact, I think that many even forget the human source. Joanne and I were talking about this in the car on the way here. I got into the car, she was listening to an economist who was talking about people learning out of the recent economic crash. And this economist was saying that they're going to understand things more fully. And I said, when you have people who are protesting and who are coming from middle-class homes who don't even understand that, you know, who simply think, well, the government will provide us with what we need. They don't even understand the fact that that stuff has to be grown out of the ground by people who work hard. Do you really think that people are going to learn? They think that what happens is they exchange paper for something that's in the frozen food section, and that's the source of food. and anyway, so we in this prosperous society, we can become like the rich kid who always gets everything and just assumes it should be there and has a sense of entitlement. But the praying part is dependent and grateful. Because the praying part understands that every good and perfect gift comes down from above, from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness or shadow of turning, as he says in James 1. The praying part understands that, as Jesus says in Matthew 6, as he's talking to the people at the Sermon on the Mount, he says, your Father knows what you have need of. He is the one who understands and then provides for us. Out of our need, he provides what we need. And so the praying heart marvels at his provision and is characterized by gratitude, because we know he owes us nothing and he gives us good gifts. And as he owes us nothing and as he gives us good gifts, then we come to him dependent. Please, please, give us our daily bread. You're the one who has provided. We acknowledge that, and we ask for your continuing provision. In practical terms, I'm going to give you one small reminder here, and it's probably already your norm, and I hope it's your norm in your home, but please make sure that you pray before you eat. No matter where you are, no matter what the circumstance, please make sure that you pray before you eat. I say that because, some people pray before and they pray after their meal. They pray thanking God for the food, and then after the meal they pray and thank God for the fact that he has given us what they have enjoyed. I think that's a very common tradition in reform circles. But as we think about this, this is a norm for many, and it used to be the norm for virtually any professing Christian. But you know what? I've been told that it's fallen by the way with many. I've been told that in many families that would profess to be Christian, this practice has fallen by the way. And I think that it's one of those things that's an important reminder to us. The simplest acknowledgement of the fact that our daily bread comes from the hand of the Father who made us. And I know it can be an empty ritual too. But it's a hugely important thing, I think, for us to continually be drawn back to the fact that we're grateful. We're grateful for and we recognize that our physical provision comes from the hand of God. Beyond this, as Christ speaks, the next thing that he talks about as far as true prayer and the true praying heart is this. True prayer is shaped by a dependence on the spiritual provision of God, dependence on the physical provision of God, but also dependence on the spiritual provision of God. And forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us, and lead us not into temptation. Now, let's understand what is not being said here as Jesus talks to his disciples and instructs them. When it says, forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us, he's not saying, forgive us our sins because you owe us, because we're already forgiven. That's not what he's saying here. So that's the thing that I want to get out of the way. Now let's look into what is being said. Spiritual provision is our greatest need, of course. The removal of rebellion from our hearts, the removal of the barrier that comes between the Father and us. And we know this. We know that the removal of our spiritual death sentence is entirely through the reality that Jesus Christ took that sentence. That's what we remembered at the communion table this morning. The barrier that stands between us and God, the death sentence that was passed on people who have rebelled against God, was entirely paid by Jesus Christ. And I'll say this, if you do not yet know Jesus Christ as your Savior, please speak with me, because I would love to speak to anyone who has not trusted Christ yet as their Savior. I would love to speak to you about trusting Christ and following Christ. But Christ's instruction here on how to pray is focused on believers living in relationship with their Father, people who have already received new life. And as he talks to them, he says this. He says, the praying heart of the believer recognizes the continual need for reconciliation with the Father, because we are prone to wander. You may be a follower of Jesus Christ, you may have trusted Christ, and you may know that you would be made just because Christ's goodness was placed in your account, he died on the cross for your sins. But the fact is still, we struggle. We wander. The fact is still, we know that we act in ways that mean that we are turning away from our Father. And the kind of heart that prays in a way that is heard by God is a heart that shows forgiveness and reconciliation with those around them. And that's why he says, forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us. This is a person who recognizes, I have received grace, and as I have received grace, I need to be gracious. As I have been forgiven, I need to be forgiving. This is significant for us. It's significant for us to see this, because the truth is, there are people who say that they are in Christ who hold grudges. Now listen to that again. There are people who say that they are in Christ who hold grudges. And Christ's teaching about the praying heart here says that that can't be. We could expand on this further in Matthew 18 with the parable there of the unforgiving servant. I'm sure that many of you know that parable. We won't take time to do that. Time doesn't allow us to go into detail. So I want to summarize the message both there and here. If you have received the saving grace of God, the saving grace of God that he extends to an unworthy offender, you must be, and you will be, gracious and forgiving to others. That's essential to a praying heart. You and I were unworthy offenders. And if you have received the grace of God in Jesus Christ, then you must be and will be gracious and forgiving to others. And that's a hard point of self-examination. Think about it this way. If you are not committed to grace and forgiveness, either A, you are not a Christian, or B, there's something seriously damaged about your walk, and your prayers for forgiveness will not be heard by God. Because the praying heart forgives and so asks for forgiveness, because it has been forgiven. Now, we could spend a whole lot more time on this, because this truth often brings with it all sorts of questions about normalizing relationships with unrepentant people, or whether we're just brushing sin under the rug, or whatever it might be. And I will say that this has to be thought through with the whole counsel of God, but this is the starting point for us. If we have praying hearts, we ask for forgiveness from God in the day-to-day spiritual walk. Having already experienced the saving forgiveness of God through Jesus Christ as grateful, unworthy servants. And if you've experienced that undeserved saving forgiveness, then you will be committed to forgiveness and grace toward others. If you're not committed to forgiveness and grace toward others, then God does not hear your prayers. I'll say it again. If you are not committed to forgiveness and grace toward others, then God does not hear your prayers. That's really big. As Christ shows us how to pray, we see that it's essential to our being true worshipers. The prayer that he calls us to pray is worship. If you are a true worshiper, you must pray. It's the recognition that we're completely, completely dependent on God. And worship is the whole tone of prayer as Christ teaches us how to pray. So true prayer doesn't arise from an arrogant heart. It doesn't arise from an unforgiving heart. It's only from a devoted and dependent heart. And this isn't a conversation between equals. It's the prayer, it's the call of a needy child to a father. We see too, true prayer isn't for self-gratification. It's not about getting what I want, but it's about wanting what he wants. That's why we pray for his kingdom to come. That's why we pray for his glory. Because you see, God knows what we need. Your Father knows what you need. And what he wills is truly good. And because of this, we want to be people who pray wanting what he wants. We want that to shape us as we call out to you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for these words, very familiar to us. But as we take them, as we look into them, words that we know it's easy to brush over. It's easy to simply say by rote, yet profoundly meaningful. Help us to be people, as we pray, who pray with worshipers' hearts, understanding what it was that caused Jesus to give this as a pattern to his followers, what it was that shaped each of these instructions. Devotion to you, devotion to your plan, dependence on you for physical provision, absolute dependence, knowledge that there is no way that we could have any spiritual provision apart from you. May we be people who come to you in prayer, true worshipers, people who acknowledge you and your greatness, who love you and who make you our highest priority. I pray this in Jesus' name.